Welcome to Together We Rise, the power of female leadership to help solve the climate crisis. Please welcome to the stage your youth climate activist co-hosts.
Welcome, everyone. We're so happy that you're able to join us tonight in person and online. My name is Xiye Bastida. I am a climate activist, the co-founder of ReEarth Initiative, and an organizer for the Fridays for Future Strikes.
Hi, and my name is Jerome Foster II. I'm a White House climate advisor and the founder and executive director of 1 Million of Us. I'm excited to be here tonight.
Hi, everyone. My name is Alexandria Villasenor. I'm a 16-year-old climate activist and the founder of Earth Uprising International.
I am so happy that we get to spend the first day of Climate Week together. Tonight, we'll hear from an intersectional, intersectoral, and intergenerational group of climate leaders about solutions, about the state of the world, and about calls to action.
Yes, and even more, tonight is about a call to action. We'll hear from thought leaders, we'll hear from business leaders, we'll hear from grassroots activists to corporate representatives, all talking about the need for change. And we're very excited to have these conversations and delve deep into the intersectionality of them all.
Everyone here, all of us at this program, are the last generation of people who are able to make sure that we get action for future generations so that they have a safe and habitable planet. And that is why tonight you will hear so many actions that you can take. You will be hearing from many different people. Make sure to pay attention to the screen because you'll be able to see all of our guests' information and how you can join them in their activism. And so now is the time for action, and I hope this event leaves you inspired.
For this night, I hope we all remember that no movement ever succeeded by thinking it was going to fail. That's a quote that I gather from the anthology All We Can Save, that was co-edited by Dr. Catherine Wilkinson and Ayanna Elizabeth Johnson. And just a reminder that our purpose in this movement is to create a culture of taking care of Mother Earth, that practice becomes part of who we are and the actions that we engage in. So with that, we can ask ourselves in good conscience, have we been a good ancestor? Are we good ancestors for future generations?
And when we talk about the energy and embodying the energy of our generation, we can only thank Amanda Gorman. I remember the day of, really on the inauguration day, of her going out in her yellow dress and her red hat, just talking so clearly and poignantly about the state of our generation and our country. And it's incredibly important that we listen to now Amanda Gorman's poem, Earthrise.
On Christmas Eve, 1968, astronaut Bill Anders snapped a photo of the Earth as Apollo 8 orbited the moon. Those three guys were surprised to see from their eyes a planet looked like an Earthrise, a blue orb hovering over the moon's gray horizon with deep oceans and silver skies. It was our world's first glance at itself, a first chance to see a shared reality, a declared stance, and a commonality, a glimpse into a planet's mirror. And as threats drew nearer, our own urgency became clearer as we realized that we hold nothing dearer than this floating body we all call home. We've known that we're caught in the throes of climactic changes some say will just go away, while some simply pray to survive another day. For it is the obscure, the oppressed, the poor, who when the disaster is declared done, still suffer more than anyone. Climate change is the single greatest challenge of our time. Of this, you're certainly aware. It's saddening, but I cannot spare you from knowing an inconvenient fact, because it's getting the facts straight that gets us to act and not to wait. So I tell you this not to scare you, but to prepare you, to dare you to dream a different reality where, despite disparities, we all care to protect this world, this riddled blue marvel, this little true marvel, to master the verve and the nerve to see how we can serve our planets. You don't need to be a politician to make it your mission to conserve, to protect, to preserve that one and only home that is ours. To use your unique power to give next generations the planet they deserve. We are demonstrating, creating, advocating. We heed this inconvenient truth because we need to be anything but lenient with the future of our youth. And while this is a training in sustaining the future of our planet, there is no rehearsal. The time is now, 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 because the reversal of harm and protection of a future so universal should be anything but controversial. So, Earth, pale blue dots, we will fail you not. Just as we chose to go to the moon, we know it's never too soon to choose hope. We choose to do more than cope with climate change. We choose to end it. We refuse to lose. We do this and more, not because it's very easy or nice, but because it is necessary. Because with every dawn, we carry the weight of the fate of this celestial body orbiting a star. And as heavy as that weight sounded, it doesn't hold us down, but it keeps us grounded, steady, ready, because an environmental movement of this size is simply another form of an Earthrise. To see it, close your eyes, visualize that all of us in this room and outside of these walls or in these halls, all of us change makers, are in a spacecraft floating like a silver raft in space, and we see the face of a planet anew. We relish the view, we witness its round green and brilliant blue, which inspires us to ask deeply, wholly, what can we do? Open your eyes, know the future of this wise planet is right in sight, right in all of us. Trust this Earth uprising, all of us bring light to exciting solutions never tried before, for it is our hope that implores us at our uncompromising core to keep rising up for an Earth more than worth fighting for.
Amanda Gorman's words were so powerful and present and perfectly depicted the state of our climate and the fortitude and hope and community that will be needed for us to move forward. Her words were so inspiring.
And we want to thank Climate Reality so much for sharing this beautiful video with us. Now, coming to us from California is the co-founder of an alliance between people of the modern world and indigenous people of the Amazon rainforest. This collaboration has successfully preserved millions of acres of their partners' lands and culture from the threat of fossil fuel companies for over 25 years. It's also been a vehicle to share the wisdom of the indigenous peoples with the modern world by providing transformative educational programs in 80 countries and 20 languages. She has just returned from her first trip to the Amazon since the pandemic hit. Please welcome co-founder of Pachamama Alliance, Lynn Twist.
Thank you so much for including me in this very, very important evening. I wish I could be in New York at the Ethical Society with all of you there. And I want to thank you for including me this way, and that we can do it this way, that all of us can be together, because it's time to gather. It is the critical moment, as you said, Alexandra and Xiye and Jerome. and Amanda Gorman. And it's my assertion that this is the Sophia century, the century when women will take our rightful role in co-equal partnership with men and the world will come into balance. The Sophia century is also a century where in both male and female energies, there will be a balancing, a rising up of the feminine in everyone, in men and women. The Sophia century for me is the first century of the third millennium, this critical time, and we're 21 years into the first century of the third millennium. And if we can call this the Sophia century, where divine wisdom is rising up, not only through women, but also through men, and taming the masculine so that we can bring those qualities that are so necessary now for the kind of world that we all want and need, and addressing the climate crisis, collaboration, community, compassion, intuition, forgiveness, spiritual energy, tenderness. We need the heart. There is one of the great prophecies of indigenous people, the prophecy of the eagle and the condor, which says precisely at this time in history, the eagle people, the people of the mind, will reach a kind of zenith in their capacity to use the mind. They'll even invent tools to extend the capacity of the mind. This is a prophecy that's been told for millennia, for thousands of years in the Amazon and the Andes. And those eagle people, the modern world people, will become materially rich beyond any previous imagination, but they will be spiritually impoverished to their peril, and their very survival will be at risk. While the condor people, which refers to indigenous people who live primarily through the wisdom of the heart, the five senses, and have incredible sophistication in the spirit world, will reach a kind of zenith in their way of being, and they will be very competent in their ways of the heart, their deep wisdom, their spiritual energy, but they will be materially impoverished in any encounter with the eagle people, and their very survival will be at risk. And the prophecy says that at this time in history, the eagle people and the condor people will remember that they are each other and rejoin the modern world people and the indigenous people. They will begin to fly together in the same skies, and the whole world will come back into balance. There's another great prophecy about the times we're living in that comes from the Baha'i faith. And those people have also, this is also taken from Cherokee lore, that they say that the bird of humanity at this time, at the beginning of the third millennium, will have been flying for centuries with primarily only one wing, that the bird of humanity has a male wing and a female wing. And that at this time in history, we will realize that the male wing has been overdeveloped, over-muscular in all of us, and has even become a bit violent because the female wing in all of us is not yet fully been expressed or extended. So that prophecy says that right around this time in history, not only will the male wing begin to relax a little bit, but the female wing will fully extend itself in all of us and be fully expressed so that the male wing can relax. And after flying in circles for centuries with only one wing, only the male wing, the bird of humanity for the first time in history will soar. So I say that the theme of this extraordinary gathering in New York right now that's taking place all over the world, of course, through this wonderful medium of technology, is the extraordinary and powerful statement that the feminine rising, that female qualities, that the qualities that are inherent in women, but also very latent in men and available to all of us, are the qualities that are needed to address the climate crisis. This is the time, this is the moment, we are the ones. And those are the qualities that need room to express, to be fully expressed in all of us. Those feminine qualities, the divine feminine, those qualities that allow us to work together, many of those qualities to begin with the word C-O-M, or the prefix C-O-M, which means with. We need to do this with each other, for Mother Earth. And it's no accident that we call her Mother. So I invite you all to listen to Indigenous wisdom, listen to the feminine in you, and join the mind and heart of humanity so that we can address these problems in a way that brings out the best in all of us. Thank you for allowing me to be part of this very important program on a very important day in a very important time in history. Thank you very much. God bless.
Thank you, Lynn, so much for your important message on wisdom and feminine wisdom. Now you're about to hear from a remarkable Indigenous leader who has been a personal inspiration and mentor on wisdom. She's a Native American lawyer, activist, author, and teacher. Please welcome Sherry Mitchell and her amazing and impactful message.
Hello, my name is Sherry Mitchell. I am from the Penobscot Nation. My family is Bear Clan from the Penobscot Nation and Crow Clan from the Passamaquoddy tribe at Tsibayak. I want to welcome you to this event and to spend a few moments thinking with you about how we can become the most effective change makers of our time. One of the things that comes through my tradition that's very important to us is constantly being reminded that we are the caretakers of our future. In my book, Sacred Instructions, I wrote that we are not placeholders in time, but guardians of the future. As guardians of the future, we have to think about our role in living in a time that is so precarious, where our relationship with Mother Earth and our sustainability on the planet really hinges on how we behave today, how we relate to Mother Earth during this time. And so one of the ways that we can think about our role as the ancestors of the future is to listen to the voices of the ancestors who have come before us. Some of those ancestors are the trees, the plants, the animals. We often hear ourselves referred to as children of the earth, and we think that that gives us some special designation. What that tells us is that we're the youngest species and that we still have a lot to learn. So as we're going through this time, I encourage you to listen to the voices of those elders in the natural world who have been demonstrating to us time and time again that our destructive ways are harming all life and destroying the possibility of life for all other species. We also have to listen to our young people. Our young people are the dream of our ancestors come to life. They are our ancestors' seventh generation. Those young people are also the bridge to the future. And they have the greatest spiritual and moral authority at this time to be speaking on behalf of the future that they will inhabit. They are the ones who are going to carry us into that future. That future belongs to them, and they have a right to be speaking on behalf of it. They also carry with them the wisdom of our ancestors and speak that wisdom to us to remind us of where we've come from, but also where we hope to go. So it's really important for us to listen to our young people. I think it's very difficult for us in the age of social media to really understand how we make change. We have become great lovers of symbolic gestures. We love to think about clever ways that we can influence people with a meme or with some type of video or with a large-scale event, even such as a march. But marches and marketing are not going to get us where we need to go. We are living in a very precarious time where we have to move ourselves away from aspiration to action. We have to move ourselves away from symbolic gestures into actually creating, managing, and encouraging sustainable lives. So as you proceed through this gathering, I ask that you think about the many ways that you as an individual can realign yourself with life. I'd like to encourage you to think about the truth in this statement that was passed on to me by one of my elders, that it is not for us to try to change the natural world in order to meet us. It is for us to change ourselves to meet the natural world so that we can be more aligned with the source of life. So as you proceed through this event and move forward with your lives following it, I would encourage you to think about how you can move yourself away from the type of life that has led to the destruction of Mother Earth and back in alignment with a life that sustains us into the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sherry. Our next presenter is the Executive Director of the Global Council on Science and the Environment, an international nonprofit that spans the boundaries of science, decision-making, and the environment, with an outreach to over 80,000 scientists. However, when we talk about science, we often don't talk about indigenous wisdom, but indigenous wisdom is science. Our indigenous brothers and sisters have lived alongside nature for thousands of years, and they've learned through field research and observation how our planet works. And just a few months ago, our next speaker's organization partnered to present a program that crossed that divide where we could meet the both of both science and indigenous wisdom. Please welcome Michelle Wyman.
Thank you so much, Jerome, and to Ethical Cultures, and for all of you for being here. I don't know how many of you have had more experiences in person. For me, this is the first time in a year and a half to see humanity and celebrate our work together. So it's a privilege. Thank you. Our relationship to knowledge and different ways of knowing offers boundless possibilities as we work together to realize the future we choose. As Sherry just noted, it is not for us to try to change the natural world to meet our needs, rather for us to change ourselves to align with the needs of the natural world in all ways, always possible. My approach to this is to engage all ways of knowing, all different types of knowledge systems, like Sherry said, including from ecosystems and the Earth herself, to deepen understanding between us all as we seek alignment with the natural world and the environment, and specifically as we deepen our collective understanding of climate change. A big part of my climate work and my climate story has been focused on relationship and the role that it plays in determining outcomes. So I want to share with you an experience that I had a few years ago now, but it's still a good one to share to inspire you all and to get you thinking about the call to action that I want to invite you to consider when you walk out of the doors tonight, and those of you that are listening, when you move forward in your day-to-day, walking the climate path that we're all on together. I grew up in a town in between Dallas and Fort Worth in Texas called Arlington. It is known for its lack of transit, and it is specifically one of the things that inspired me to engage in this work as my career and as my life. I always promised myself I would go back and work with the mayor and the elected officials there to talk to them about how they might consider differently the way they were leading and designing their city, again, for the future we choose. So I studied this mayor when I finally had my chance to engage with him. I studied his campaign, his platform, the issues, and I looked at his background. And he was a part-time mayor. He was also president of the local hospital. Now, this wasn't a small town, about 500,000 in size. Mayors don't often talk about their politics. Local elected officials don't often talk about their politics, at least outside of larger cities. But it was clear he was a Republican and not a supporter of climate change. Every elected official is required, by virtue of being in office, to take a meeting with a constituent, whether you voted for them or not. So I was stubborn, and I kept calling and calling and requesting and requesting, and finally I got my meeting with the mayor. And I was really nervous. I hadn't done much of this before. And I walked in, and the first thing he said to me, he didn't sit down. He said, "Listen, this is going to be really quick if you're going to talk to me about global warming." And I looked at him, and I said, "No, sir, that's not why I'm here. I'm here to talk to you about the master plan that you've just voted on and passed in your city. I'm here to talk to you as a doctor about the asthma rates that will, without question, based on data and science, the asthma rates that will increase in those neighborhoods, particularly among the most vulnerable populations in that local place, if you continue on the path that you're on." So he sat down and we started talking, and I pulled out my data and my research and I walked him through it all, and we became connected. It took about 2.5 years of these types of meetings and building relationship with him. Within 2.5 years, he became known as the Texas mayor speaking loudly and clearly on climate change. He told it from his perspective, but he actually did say the words. He became the leading advocate among locally elected officials, not only in Texas, but in the South. He led a movement of mayors from both sides of the aisle all the way to meet with different mayors in different countries. He helped everyone recognize the importance of local action. So I want to share this with all of you as my call to action to each of you, to encourage you to get to know one of your local elected officials. We all have them, no matter where you live. And pick a tougher one. Study them. Invite them for a meeting. And if they say no, keep trying. Every single one of these people are in office because they're looking to build legacy and they want to make their community a better place. Help them do that. And understand that this is the long game. Building trust and relationships take time, especially if your aim is to change a person's belief or their position on a really tough issue like climate change. But if each of us did this today, each of you listening, imagine the movement accelerator that would have. The last thing I want to leave you with, and I always keep this in my pocket and I keep it close to my heart, never forget that you have knowledge, all of these different knowledge systems and science, as your superpower. It's accessible to everyone right now. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Michelle, for your message on how we as constituents do count. And we are supposed to contact representatives to implement all of these really important policies. Next up, we have Dr. Catherine Wilkinson, who is a social scientist, writer, and activist, and has been a huge inspiration for both Alexandria and I, as well as a mentor, laying down the work for feminist and intersectional climate solutions.
First off, with Drawdown, and then with, of course, All We Can Save, which she co-edited. And it's, for those who don't know, All We Can Save is, it's a book with many women in climate that talks about solutions and things that you can do to take action. And that was a huge inspiration for me as well, and we were able to be a part of that. And now,
please welcome Dr. Catherine Wilkinson, who is joining us from Atlanta.
Jan, thank you so much. You have both been huge inspirations and also mentors for me. So thank you. So All We Can Save takes its title from a stanza of the urban enrichment of natural resources. My heart is moved by all I cannot see. So much has been destroyed. I have to pass along with those who age after age, perversely, with no extraordinary power, reconstitute the world. It was very hard, actually, to name this anthology And that stanza inspired the name that it came to claim as its own, because our hearts are also moved by all we cannot say, but also by all we cannot understand. And All We Can Save was born out of inspiration from the amazing work and wisdom of women leading on climate, but also out of frustration about the imbalance of voices in the climate conversation, about the ideas and perspectives that get sidelined, the solutions that get ignored, about a status quo approach that simply doesn't have the time to be done. And maybe most importantly, about the better futures that are possible that keep getting delayed and denied and fractured in the climate movement. So my wonderful co-editor and dear friend, Ayanna Elizabeth Johnson, and I conceived of and created this anthology as a counterbalance, an intercession of sorts. And I am so very delighted that one of the book's many ripple effects was inspiring the focus of this event tonight. And the pages of All We Can Save hold writings on truth, courage, and solutions for the climate crisis from 60 women who are leading the way in various ways. And five of the incredible essayists are part of tonight's program: Sherry Mitchell, Jackie Patterson, Emily Atkin, and of course, Xiye and Alexandria. And bringing together essays, poetry, and art, the anthology really invites a whole human approach to this topic. And as we center women's leadership tonight, it seems only right to call in the grandmother of climate science, Eunice Newton Foote. It's a name you may not know, since she rarely gets the credit she's due. But in 1856, Eunice Newton Foote theorized that changes in carbon dioxide in the atmosphere could affect the Earth's temperature. And she arrived at that breakthrough idea through experimentation. She had an air pump, two glass cylinders, and four thermometers, and she used them to test the impact of carbonic acid gas, that was the term for carbon dioxide at the time, against what she called common air. And when placed in the sun, she found that the cylinder of carbon dioxide trapped more heat and stayed hot longer. And from that simple experiment, she connected the dots between carbon dioxide and planetary warming. And she did it 165 years ago. The paper she wrote documenting her research was presented in August 1856 at a meeting of the American Association for the Advancement of Science, and then it was published. That was 3 years before the Irish physicist John Tyndall, who is often called the grandfather of climate science, published his own more detailed research on heat-trapping gases. And I actually went to graduate school in a place where there is a Tyndall Center for Climate Research. We don't even have a photograph of Eunice Newton Foote. You may be wondering if Tyndall knew about her paper. It's unclear, though he did publish research on colorblindness in the very same issue of the same journal that she did. And whether he knew or not, we may never know. But we have to wonder if Eunice Newton Foote ever found herself remarking, "So many happy. Dude, I literally just said that." But here's the thing. She wasn't only a scientist. Foote was involved in the early movement for women's rights, too. Her name appears on the list of signatories to the 1848 Seneca Falls Declaration of Sentiments, which of course was a manifesto created during the first women's rights convention in the United States. Interestingly enough, Tyndall opposed giving women the right to vote. So faithful to both science and equality, it seems that Eunice Newton Foote was an early climate feminist. If you're not quite sure what that means, climate feminist, climate feminism, I hope that you'll let the voices in this book be a guide. And better still, I hope you'll read it with some friends and family, maybe some fellow good troublemakers, as an All We Can Save circle. You can find open source resources for that on our website of the All We Can Save project, which is allwecansave.earth. And I would be remiss not to piggyback on Michelle's call to action and also ask you all to go to call 4climate.com, callforclimate.com, and call your representatives and your senators now to let them know how critical it is that they pass robust climate policy. This is our opening. We probably won't have another one for a generation. My podcast co-host, Leah Stokes, will be tracking the data, so we'd love to see a spike in that tonight. May we rise together and put the mightiest possible we into all we can save. Thanks, y'all.
Thank you so much, Catherine, for those wonderful words. I just had an event earlier today where Catherine was a panelist, and she talked about the fact that we need to build a team that is so big and so large and so intersectional that we actually get all of the solutions that we need to implement done because there's a cultural shift attached to them. So thank you, Catherine, again. Our next speaker is the director of Drawdown Labs, Jamie Alexander. For a little bit of background, Project Drawdown is a nonprofit research organization that seeks to help the world reach drawdown, the future point in time when levels of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere stop climbing and actually start declining. Its inaugural body of work on climate solutions was the 2017 publication of the New York Times bestselling book, Drawdown, which has become a seminal text on climate solutions. And Drawdown Labs is a Project Drawdown private sector testing ground for accelerating and scaling climate solutions as quickly, safely, and equitably as possible. Their philosophy is that individual companies can offer the world a powerful new ways to address the climate crisis at an unprecedented scale. So with that background that you now have on Drawdown, please welcome Jamie Alexander.
This moment in human history calls for transformation, for reimagining and rebuilding every sector of society that right now is incompatible with a stable climate and an equitable world. That can feel overwhelming, but our work at Project Drawdown shows that we know what needs to be done, and we already have at our fingertips the wisdom, practices, and technologies to do it. So using technologies we already have in hand, we can transform the ways we power our homes, produce our food, construct our buildings, move about the world, and the way we exist in relationship with nature, our communities, and one another. This kind of change is going to take more than a few people with sustainability in their job title. This kind of change calls for a flood of new voices, diverse perspectives and skill sets, everyone from all backgrounds and job functions to find their inroad to how each of us can play a role in helping build a just climate future. We need to democratize climate action because every job is a climate job now. We need builders, growers, city planners, accountants, electricians, cooks, storytellers, investors and innovators, designers, activists, poets, and all the rest. The work of building the world we all want and sustaining it for eons to come is a pursuit worthy of the sum total of all human energy. And so many people want to contribute. That's why we at Drawdown Labs are thrilled to announce the release of Climate Solutions at Work, a guide to unleashing your employee power. It's a playbook for employees from any role across any business to help find their inroad to apply climate to their jobs and help hold their businesses accountable to the action required. Businesses have a lot of levers at their disposal that can either be used to support climate action or be complicit in further climate destruction. Their greenhouse gas emissions, but also their policy influence, lobbying activities, investments, leadership, governance structures, and more. A drawdown aligned business is one that is completely aligned with the parameters of a just climate future, and employees can help their businesses get there. For too long, we've been trying to put parameters and constraints around something that is uncontainable. But the climate crisis doesn't fit into our neatly defined boxes as much as we wish it would. It's flooding and uprooting every aspect of our lives, so responding to it with that same level of expansiveness is the only way forward. We must enable the work to happen everywhere, by everyone, at all levels, and for the work to take a much broader shape than we have ever imagined. It's time to make every job a climate job. Let's open the floodgates.
Thank you so much, Jamie. What you're doing is such important work. And what you're creating for employees to get involved in their organizations is so fantastic. And another example of an organization that is really championing and embodying what a powerful force businesses can be are the co-sponsors of this event, Salesforce and Accenture. Their partnership in sustainability and their teams are working to really support activists on the ground and achieves the goals we must in this next decade. Next is Patrick Flynn. His job is to define and lead the executive actions of Salesforce with regard to their environmental strategy and their implementation of climate action. We are so excited to see the Vice President of Sustainability of Salesforce and the Global Leader of Customer Relations Management is with us. So please welcome Patrick Flynn.
Thank you so much, Jerome. Thank you to all of the organizers, the whole staff, everybody for joining here today. It's such an honor to be with you. Climate change is first and foremost about equality. It's those with the least who suffer the most, and we are robbing the vibrancy from future generations. Today, we are alive by some unknowable reason with incredible agency at a time when the world, the planet, doesn't know how to yell more loudly for help. And while the evidence is heavy, tragic, daunting, draining, there's this incredible bright side to it. With so much at stake, there's never been greater positive impact available to any human beings alive like that of taking bold climate action now. We each have a responsibility to act, and in this emergency, we are prepared. We each only need to bring what we do best to the table. And that's as true for the individual as it is for the organization. At Salesforce, doing what we do best, we aim to accelerate the world's businesses to net zero, to sequester 100 gigatons of carbon by mobilizing the conservation, restoration, and growth of a trillion trees on this planet over the next decade, and to ignite an ecopreneur revolution, because we know that the true purpose of business is to improve the state of the world. I'll be joined in a moment by two incredible leaders, but first, a short video that hopes to explain what we think it looks like when Salesforce and Accenture both focus on what they do best in this epic moment.
The world is an infinitely complex place, which can make the problems of the world feel insurmountable. And so our challenges grow, and no one individual feels powerful enough to solve them. But no one individual is responsible for solving them. Because no matter how complex our challenges are, they are all shared and interconnected, which means the solutions can be too, if we work together. Every business and every person in the entire world is a stakeholder in the same fight, the fight to save our environment, the fight for the equitable treatment and inclusion of everyone, the fight to achieve true sustainability across every measure. Not just a sustainable climate, a flourishing economy, thriving relationships, a healthier world. Salesforce and Accenture share a vision of business as a platform for change, building solutions to embed sustainability into the core of business with unrivaled technology, ingenuity, and years of experience helping businesses to adapt to change. We're joining forces so we can join forces with you. It's a massive challenge, It's a world-changing opportunity. This is our moment. Let's seize it together.
Welcome, ladies. For the next few minutes, we're going to chat with you both about your journey and bringing your superpowers to the table in this moment. I'm joined by Avery Schlicker, an incredible leader on the Salesforce sustainability team, somebody who I owe so much gratitude to for all that she's done, and Apricot Tang, equally grateful for your work out of Accenture, and the two of them form an amazing team. I want to begin by asking you about your journeys into the roles that you find yourselves in. Often, you know, we're talking a lot tonight about taking action, finding ways to align your superpower to what the planet needs. Each of you has an incredible story there, and it took some elbowing to make happen. Avery, tell us a little bit about your journey to where you ended up here today.
Yes, so first, thank you all so much, as Patrick said, for being here. And I do want to say to Michelle and Jamie's point, Patrick and I have had many conversations about everyone has a part, find your superpower. It doesn't matter what it is, but find it. And on paper, I have no business being here. I was an English major and a studio art minor. That tracks. But when you know that this is your passion and this is what you can do the best, you can't lose. Something in you says that. And so when my first kind of thought for anyone who is either in climate or not working in climate is find your people. And so when I was working at Salesforce in a different role, finding the people in our employee resource group, Earthforce, who are as passionate as I am, and then expanding that group, and then understanding our business in a way that I saw the need. Salesforce, I'm so thrilled to say, actually walks the talk, which is, I'm very grateful for that. And so when I saw that business need, truly, like, wrote my own job description, and in that pitch I made to the powers that be for it, I was like, there will be no one who will work harder. No one will do this the way I will. And so it really is finding what you can do best and where and making it happen.
Thank you for fighting your way in. Apricot, how about you? How did you come to the role you're in right now?
Yeah, it's a good question. And I'll echo Avery's excitement in saying just thank you for having me. You know, I grew up in the San Francisco Bay Area where there's just this profound belief that everyone really kind of believes in, and that's that ideas can change the world. And you guys working at a company like Salesforce, headquartered in San Francisco, probably know and feel that sentiment. And I took that with me to college for four really formative years of my life where I was engaging in these incredible dialogues about politics, philosophy, sociology, economics, ecology, and the intersections of all those topics, intersection being a kind of theme throughout the night that I very much hold near and dear to my heart, having, you know, felt the kind of power of having dialogues about those things. And when I came to Accenture, I think one of the major reasons why was because as a company of 500,000 people, there are so many incredible thinkers in the company itself, but also with the companies that we talk to every single day, our clients, our customers, people who are kind of feeling the pains of needing help. And that idea of engaging in dialogue, it's just something that kind of stuck with me, and everyone has something that they're so passionate about, and for me, that was always sustainability. I kind of just kept talking about it. And at some point, someone remembered that and said, hey, I'm running this huge partnership around sustainability with Salesforce. Why don't you help me run the team? And it was kind of one of those moments where I was like, it just all clicked for me. And I'm very fortunate to be in the position I'm in now.
That's so exciting. And I want to hear more about the work and what you and Avery do together. So bring us into that a little bit. Tell us how the partnership works.
Yeah, love that question. You know, Avery and I started working at the beginning of this year together, and another theme of the night that I've really appreciated is collaboration And in a lot of ways, I have this like teacher and mentor and friend in Avery. You know, she brings her humanity to work, which is something I so admire about her. The tears, the anxieties, you know, the laughter. But someone who understands the absurdities, the challenges, and the kind of happiness that you go through. And I think both of us are just so deeply committed to being curious about the climate change problem. We are constantly asking each other questions. When we're in client meetings together, we're asking our clients questions. And that kind of idea of engaging in dialogue, it's something that Avery and I think, have in a really great kind of working relationship. It's just been awesome to have a partner in crime.
Awesome. And Avery, from your side?
I think to add to that, the thing that I've seen, I echo all of that. It's phenomenal to have a partner in crime like that. But what I've seen that's been really exciting, especially in the past year, is that in every conversation we have with every company, every person, it doesn't matter who, everyone is trying to figure it out. No one has the answer. You know, carbon reduction, we've set public targets, we've set goals. How do we get there? And no one has the answer. But being able to work in these large companies, you know, you were able to kind of have that network and have those conversations. And it's just fascinating what we learn and can share. And everyone wants to be in that group together because no one knows, you know, we're all like, let's get all the brains in the room and just learn from each other. And it's so cool. And so that's what I've just been most excited about. And that's what gives me hope too, yeah, about what we can really achieve.
That's, you know, I know a lot of the audience is interested in how they can get into climate action, what steps they can take. And it's not always going to be digital transformation tools and professional consulting services changing businesses. It can be anything, but the advice probably spans the context as well. So what advice do you have for those out there who are trying to think about how to lean in and take action right now?
My advice to people is always, it's so overwhelming. It can make your head explode. But it sounds almost trite, but what small thing can you do every day? And what can you bring to your job? What can you bring to your life, your family? And kind of, again, find your people and expand that. And then who knows, that turns into a career someday.
Yeah, you know, for me, I think it's be curious, ask questions. Your company probably publishes an annual environmental, social, and governance report. Do you understand that report? Do you understand how you're contributing to the numbers in that report? You know, from the person who is coding program at Google, do you understand how to write energy efficient code, to the HR manager who's helping with hiring practices? Do you understand what it means to be inclusive and diverse in your day-to-day lives? I think just asking yourself those questions and also asking that of the people you work with, in some ways, you know, dialogue has been the kind of most enriching thing for me in my job, and it's gotten me to where I am here. So I just encourage everyone to be curious and keep talking.
Yeah, and you know, it also sounds like in each of your cases, dialogue, communication, metaphorically raising your hand as the person interested in this topic and signaling that there's a willingness there. That's something you both share, yeah?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah. How do you originate that? You know, where does that come from?
I was the weird little kid, like the don't waste paper kid. So I don't know. I was just
in you.
Always, yeah.
Yeah.
No good answer but that.
Yeah, and I think maybe I was an only child, and I just really wanted to talk to people, and I was just always really interested to understand people's lived experiences because, you know, I had one way of growing up and I was always curious, what did everyone else kind of experience? And I think that's just kind of stayed with me.
Yeah. Well, that sort of motivation is incredibly inspiring. Thank you both for everything you do every day. Thank you for joining us here on stage.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you. And as the founder of 1 Million of Us, an organization that worked to mobilize over 1.2 million young people in America, that idea of mass mobilization and reaching that critical number of 1 million is very close to my heart. So across the world and down under, one of the fiercest people who have kept genuine to the idea of 1 million is 1 million women. And to give you a glimpse of their commitment, let's take a look at their anthem.
You're the voice, try and understand it. Make a noise and make it clear. gonna sit in silence. We're not gonna live with sin. Whoa. You're the first try and understand it. Make a noise and make it clear. Whoa, 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 whoa. We're not gonna sit in silence. We're not gonna live with fear. Whoa, 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 whoa.
That was amazing. Oftentimes, it's art and activism and the merger of both that have the most powerful impact on our communities. And now here, as the founder of 1 Million Women, a total force of nature, please welcome Natalie Isaacs.
Hello, everyone. I'm talking to you from Sydney, Australia. You know, for many, many years before I started 1 Million Women, I thought climate change was somebody else's problem. I thought that I was just one person, and what could one person really do to make a difference? But then I started to reduce emissions in my own life, and I saw tangible results. And I realized at that point I was powerful and everything changed. And I started 1 Million Women because I wanted to reach other women that were just like me, or I was disengaged for whatever reason. And I wanted to bring them along the road of empowerment. And now today, 1 Million Women is a movement of over 1 million women and girls from across the globe committed to living climate action. And it's that action, that one action that has a tangible result that propels you to the next action and the next. And it helps you find your voice and build your confidence. And it takes you all the way to using your vote and holding others accountable for their climate inaction. In all the time that I've been doing 1 Million Women, I have met incredible people from across the world, global leaders, right through to people that are holding their supermarkets accountable for their waste and their plastic pollution. This is the defining moment for the world, and it needs us all to do whatever we can in whatever capacity, wherever we are. So let's love the earth like we do our family and friends right here in our hearts. You know, let's take a breath before we buy something and ask ourselves, do I really need it? Let's shift our money away from banks and financial institutions that continue to invest in fossil fuels. And let's get politically engaged like never before and encourage others to do the same. And wherever we are, let's build community. Because community builds resilience. It makes us optimistic and it strengthens our determination. You know, the 1 Million Women anthem that you just heard had such powerful words. And I just wanted to say this from the chorus: this time we know we can stand together with the power to be powerful, believing that we can make it better. You know, those are the words for this time. Never, ever underestimate the power that you have and the power that we have collectively, millions of us, doing what we can to change the world.
That was incredible to hear. Thank you so much, Natalie. And that is very true. Never underestimate your power. Our next speaker, I am so excited to announce. He is a contributor to The New Yorker. He's the Schumann Distinguished Professor in Residence at Middlebury College in Vermont and is the founder of 350.org. His greatest achievements are inspiring people, of course, but he has written over 30 years, dozens of books about the environment. Please welcome Bill McKibben.
And especially to get to join you on this occasion to talk about something that struck me almost from the beginning of the 30 years that I've been working on this climate challenge, which is that most of the people that I was working with were women. Kim Stanley Robinson, in his wonderful new book, Ministry for the Future, really the greatest novel perhaps of the global warming era yet, has as his hero a woman who's leading the world's efforts to deal with this crisis. And she's a combination maybe of Christiana Figueres and Mary Robinson and Laurent Tubiana, the women who helped bring us the Paris Climate Accords. It's a fascinating fact, and I don't know precisely what it's rooted in, but it has something to do with the sheer doggedness in the face of very difficult and dangerous facts. It's possible that women are less prone to tell themselves stories that try and relieve them of the responsibility of dealing with reality. Because reality is what we have to deal with. And the oil companies and whatever are dealing in fantasy now and have been for a long time, trying to convince us that everything is all right. And instead, we've needed people with enormous sense of empathy and a sense of and a talent for solidarity, maybe above all. You know, we can't solve this crisis as individuals. We're past the point where we can make the climate math work one Tesla at a time, one vegan dinner at a time. The most important thing an individual can do is be a little less of an individual, to join together with others in movements large enough to make things happen. And those movements are so wonderful. I think of things like the Sunrise Movement and its great leader, Varshini Prakash, who I've known since she was working hard to divest the University of Massachusetts from fossil fuels. One thinks of Greta Thunberg and all the thousands of other great Greta Thunbergs there are scattered around the planet leading high school and junior high school students. And I think of wonderful, wonderful colleagues like Mae Boovy, who it is an enormous honor to get to introduce. I knew Mae when she was 20 or 21 and just beginning her work as an activist, and already it was remarkably apparent that she was going to be one of those people who changed the world, and indeed she has. And what a privilege to get to work with her for so many years. And what a privilege to learn from her. Now we're trying to apply some of those skills as we develop this new campaign for older people, Third Act, which is all about providing intergenerational support to the young people, especially young women who are leading these campaigns around the world. Do this work at Third Act, I'm reminded once again that it's mostly women who are involved and in charge. Partly that's demographic. Among other things, women are better at living longer than men are. But mostly it's because of this constellation of qualities about empathy and solidarity and commitment, and above all, that bone dry understanding of reality that lets them reliably take the lead. None more so than May, who I have watched from one corner of the planet to the other, help people come to grips with this greatest of crises and help them discover their agency and their ability to do something about it. So what a pleasure to get to turn the mic over to her.
Thank you, Bill, and thank you so much to the organizers of this event. I really appreciate the opportunity to talk about a topic very near and dear to my heart. And I want to give a special shout out to 350 NYC and 350 Brooklyn. The theme I want to focus on for this event is the value and the need for the climate movement to be effective, and how this work of building relationships and keeping connections strong is what makes us effective, and it is very often the work of feminists in the climate movement. It is vital that we recognize this for the hard work that it is and the ticking engine that makes all of our work successful. I can simply speak from my own experience and observations that it is my feminist colleagues, the majority of them women, who help keep the many organizations and individuals in the climate movement connected to one another and to our sister social movements. It is my feminist colleagues who reach out to me when a relationship needs to be healed, when feedback needs to be given, when hard work needs to be praised. They stop problems before they start. They are also working late into the night, making sure policies have had the proper consultation, that treaties are honored, that sacred land is protected. This is the often invisible, vital work of movement building, and it is laying the groundwork for the work ahead. The IPCC report makes clear the challenge we face, and early signs show that it moved many more people to concern than similar reports like it. This is good. It means more people are ready to join the movement. How will we welcome them? How will we encourage them to join forces with what already exists and not create new entities that reinvent the wheel? How can we extend with open arms the lessons learned in previous decades of the climate fight? There is hope. We are living through the golden age of social movements, led by women and queer and trans women of color, whether it is Me Too or Black Lives Matter or the climate justice movement. We are living through a time when the invisible labor of women is becoming visible, unignorable, and it is shifting power. And that power shift is helping us to realize a just transition. It is in that shifting of power that we see real change in people's lives and where we find our own strength. And it is in its opposition where we understand what we are up against. I'll give an example. I am still grieving about the Supreme Court's decision to uphold the horrifying abortion law in Texas. I feel about reproductive freedom the way I think a lot of people feel about climate change. It feels huge, and because I'm not embedded in that movement, I often feel despairing about it. But that too can change when we connect across movements. Over the past few years, thanks to the work of women like Bridget Burns at WEDO, the Women's Environment and Development Organization, Evelyn Shen at Forward Together, and Ellen Friedman at the Compton Foundation, women across movements are linking up and getting involved in each other's struggles beyond theoretical awareness of how our fights are connected. They are both about power and not having it, and the consequences of that, which in our case is a world on fire and freedom and dignity being under attack. At 350, our focus is to build a more powerful movement to cut off the pillars of support of the fossil fuel industry. And it is my feminist colleagues all over the world, from Japan to Indonesia to South Africa to the United States, who are leading these fights against fossil fuel financing and building movements to do so. My colleague Lisette in the Netherlands is taking on Shell. My colleagues Charity and Rukia. My colleagues Clemence are taking on Total. My colleague Hong in Vietnam has faced incredible threats to her own security for advocating for clean energy. I mention all of them because what they represent to me is people who are using all of their agency and power to fight for a better world. We all have so much more power than we sometimes think. And I invite you to join them and me and all of us at 350 to take part in these actions, even today. Finally, so much of this work is about our worldview and our behavior. It is our connection to each other where we find the solace and the solutions that we need. I just gave birth to my first child, a daughter, and through her eyes, I can see that there is still so much beauty in the world. I love the idea of all we can save, and I thank the co-creators and authors of that book for that powerful concept. There is indeed all we can save by working together. Thank you.
Thank you so much, May and Bill, for sharing your important message. Now, I'm excited about this next conversation with an award-winning climate journalist. She left mainstream media to be able to report the real stories she knew needed to be told now about climate. She's also a frequent guest on MSNBC. And so I'm thrilled to be in conversation with Emily Atkin. Hi.
Hey, what's
I'm
up?
So glad to be able to meet you. I retweet you all the time.
Same, ditto. It's nice to finally have this Twitter friendship be real life.
Exactly. So I am really excited to be talking with you. And so I already mentioned this in my introduction, but why don't you just tell us a little bit more about, well, your background and why you left mainstream media?
I've been a journalist since I've learned what journalism was. I'm from New York originally, and after I left college, I went straight into mainstream media, and after about, 9 or so years, I kind of felt like the mainstream journalism, particularly when it came to climate change, wasn't serving the principle that I was taught to love about journalism, which is that it speaks truth to power, and that it's supposed to serve democracy by doing that, by lifting up the voiceless. And particularly on climate change, I felt that there wasn't enough outrage, not enough anger, not enough truth to power. And so that was, you know, that was something I wanted to do every single day. I didn't want it to just be, I could pitch it once a month and hopefully an editor would greenlight it. You know, I wanted my rage at greenwashing and climate denial and all the stuff that's really kept climate policy from moving forward. I wanted that to be on the docket every single day. So that's why I did it.
Yeah, it's important that we see climate change in the news like every single day because it's happening every single day. And so you talk a lot about being a climate journalist. And why do you think every journalist should be a climate journalist?
Well, every journalist lives in the climate. and every journalist is supposed to cover, the issues that affect the people in their communities. And, I've said it before that if people who are journalists are not covering climate change today, if they plan to be a journalist in 10 years, they will be. We don't have enough climate coverage as it is, and that's because we expect climate journalists to cover everything about the climate crisis. So how it affects housing, how it affects immigration, how it affects conflict, how it affects our food system, how it affects politics. You have one climate reporter for all of that, and your politics desk and immigration desk doesn't cover climate. It's just stupid. One of the things I do at the newsletter is I talk a lot about journalism itself because that's really my passion and what I love. And I really do feel that, journalism as a whole hasn't really done enough to understand climate change. It hasn't equipped its journalists to be climate journalists. And so what I really love doing is telling people as a form of activism, you know, tell it, you have a paper, right? Like a newspaper, a news source you read all the time. If something pisses you off about how they're doing it, let them know, because they do serve you. You know, they serve communities. That's what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to listen to you.
Mm-hmm. You know, I think you touched on something about how, you know, climate change is affecting every single sector of our society. And, you know, I do like to think that there is more reporting happening because it is becoming so much more urgent. But I do want to ask you, because you're in this, and have you seen the climate journalism change over the past year or so? What has changed and what needs to start happening right away?
Yeah, it's definitely changed in that there's more of it, and that's really great. And I think a lot of editors and people are starting to realize that they want to see more climate coverage. But I think what really hasn't clicked in a lot of people's minds, especially editors at your big mainstream organizations, is that climate change is caused by fossil fuels, and that's an objective fact. And so when you're covering climate change, you really have to always make that connection to fossil fuels. And a lot of editors and journalists who cover politics these days, they don't understand the fossil fuel industry's immense political power and the scientific degree to which they cause climate change, not just by their emissions, but with money, propaganda, controlling messaging. And then most of your news institutions run fossil fuel advertising. Advertising that literally says, fossil fuels are doing amazing to solve the climate crisis. We do so much. And also natural gas is a clean fuel, you know? There's so much greenwashing going on that people who are supposed to be the arbiters of our information don't even recognize. The people that are supposed to be the gatekeepers of truth don't understand what the truth is about climate change. They don't see greenwashing when they see it. You're going to see it all over Climate Week NYC this week. You're going to see sponsors of this whole week be companies that are literally building natural gas pipelines in New York City. National Grid is a sponsor of Climate Week. Siemens is a sponsor of Climate Week. And they build infrastructure for the oil and gas industry. There's so much truth that we're not telling. But that's also an opportunity, because there's great stories to be told, and journalism is the most amazing way, I think, to make a difference.
I wish that we could keep talking about this, but do you have any last words or call to action to leave with everyone here?
Sure. I have a newsletter. it's called Heated, but, you know, it's once a week, and I have my approach to it, and I have, you know, the way that I like to cover climate change, but really my call to action is support any kind of journalism, any journalists, and don't abandon journalists and your favorite paper when they do something bad. Hold them accountable, because that's what you want them to do for everyone else in your life. You know, make journalism better and hold its feet to the fire.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, thank you so much for joining us. And, you know, I think that everybody needs to start paying attention to media, making sure that they tell the truth. So thank you so much for pushing them.
Thank you so much, Emily and Alexandria, for that. And, you know, as Alexandria said, it's an important reminder of what our professions are for. And journalism is for truth. So let's call that truth to power. Coming up soon, you're also going to hear from Al Gore, Deepak Chopra, and watch a performance from a 14-year-old singer. But first, I would like to introduce our next speaker, Jackie Patterson, who is the founder of the Chisholm Legacy Project. For more than a decade, our next speaker was the environmental climate justice movement head at the NAACP. After her long tenure there, she left to found the Chisholm Legacy Project, which its mission is rooted in a just transition framework, serving to connect Black communities on the front lines of climate justice with resources to traverse the path from vision to strategy to action. So now please welcome Jackie Patterson, who is joining us from a very beautiful and a little windy beach.
Good day. It is such an honor to share the virtual stage with these awesome women to uplift the purpose and power of women's leadership under the banner of Together We Rise. What a inspiring and encouraging moniker to serve as the frame for our conversation today. In the words of Shirley Chisholm, the first African-American woman to serve in Congress and the first woman and the first African-American to run for president, at present, our country needs women's idealism and determination, perhaps more in politics than anywhere else. Though she made that remark in the 1970s, the sentiment is truly timeless. In the climate movement, we've seen how women's innovation and determination has moved mountains. With work rooted in the principles of the Just Transition Framework, including regeneration, cooperation, caring for the sacred, and deep democracy, a recognition that we can only design our Earth systems in a way that follows the divine order of biomimicry that we see in our natural ecosystems, where we see ant colonies and bee colonies and zebra coming together with one cause. One cause is to protect all, and particularly to protect the most vulnerable in our society, but to even make sure that the systems are designed in such a way that we don't have vulnerabilities in the first place. So I see so many examples of this in the climate movement being embodied in the work of women's leadership. Leah Penniman and Ife Kilimanjaro at the Soul Fire Farm are advancing food justice and recognizes that the earth gives what we need, and we can design our food systems in a way that is in resonance with that regenerative nature of food production. The Kara Page of the Southern Healing Collective and Huda Alkaf of Green Muslims are advancing healing justice, recognizing that with the harms that we have done in our society and in our past, that healing justice is critical for us to be able to move on and re-engineer, for lack of a better word, but redesign our system so that we are living in harmony with each other and with the earth. Jaisha Dutter of Another Gulf is Possible and Bernice Shaw of Center for Story-Based Strategy are advancing culture work and narrative strategy. Colette Pichon Battle of Gulf Coast Center for Law and Poverty and Monique Verdun of Home and Nation are advancing disaster equity, responding to sea level rise in ways that are just and equitable, advancing just transition lawyering and onward. Jessica Tovar, Chandra Farley, and Eiko Schaefer are recognizing that energy justice can only be achieved with racial justice, indigenous justice, workers' rights, and human rights at the center. Lindsay Baker, Mandy Lee, and Kimberly Lewis are seeing that regenerative design and biomimicry are necessary even in the design of our buildings and in the built environment. Melanie Allen, Gloria Walton, Aaron Rogers are leading organizations that are supporting BIPOC women's leadership in climate. Beverly Wright and Peggy Shepherd and Donnell Wilkins have revived the National Black Environmental Justice Network, seeing that we need to come together in order to win together. Monica Atkins, Benishi Albert, and Marion G are coming together to co-lead, to provide a model of leadership that really wraps arms together in leadership of the Climate Justice Alliance, where they're anchoring a just transition framework. Latasha Brown of Black Voters Matter is advancing leadership on civic engagement, which brought out voters across the nation, and Black women were credited with saving the elections in Alabama and Georgia, and some say saving democracy itself. So again, following the leadership of these awesome women, following the leadership of the way that the earth is designed divinely, we can really get to where we need to be in terms of truly advancing liberty, justice, human rights, dignity, and harmony with the earth. Thank you.
Thank you. And that was a really important message about the role of Black people and Black women in America, especially when we talk about environmental racism, when we see that over 80% of coal-fired power plants are placed in our communities. Let's talk about that systemic injustice. But moving on to the next speaker is a really important topic about how we need to include faith and spirituality. The contribution of the faith in spiritual communities around the world is more needed than ever. And here, Rabbi Ginny has spent more than two decades advocating for social change and has created dynamic new initiatives at the heart of the Jewish social justice movement. And Rabbi Ginny was moved by the urgency of the climate crisis that she created a new and rapidly growing organization that mobilizes the American Jewish community to confront the climate crisis.
It's so meaningful to be here as part of Together We Rise. We're living in such a dark and frightening time in human history, and we face the climate crisis in all its devastation and pain. Many of us with great anxiety, grief, fear, perhaps guilt. And it's important to face the raw truth of this moment, not to look away, but critically to do so with others in community, gatherings like this. This is a moment that calls for spiritual courage. We feel the urgency and hope. We feel the direness and the possibility. We see the world as it is, and we imagine the world as it could be, as it should be. Today, we face intersecting crises, the pandemic and the economic devastation that it's wrought, insidious racial injustice, and climate destruction at an unfathomable scale. And we have an opportunity to address these colliding crises and to re-envision and rebuild a different kind of world, one that is just and livable for all people. But it will take courage and vision. It'll take boldness, leadership, and organizing to transform our world. Facing the climate crisis requires all of us to remember and to really lean into our collective power, because we have tremendous collective power. This is a time for bold action, not for incremental action. We need responses and solutions at the scale and speed that science and justice demand. None of us can sit this out. We come together to close the gap between the world as it is and the world as it should be, not by inching them closer incrementally, but by reimagining and rebuilding a radically different future. It's difficult, really, to overstate the potential of this moment, this existentially critical window of time we have to pull our world back from the brink of destruction. And in order to mitigate the most devastating impacts of climate change, in order to address climate injustice and to avert total climate collapse, we need to take action on a systemic level. This means things like cutting demand for and supply of fossil fuel energy, advocating for comprehensive climate policy, moving our money, and changing our political landscape. It means building and joining a holy movement. This is the kind of transformational change that this moment in history demands, and everyone has a role to play. Everyone. We're in a moment of profound urgency, but also a moment of profound possibility. Dayenu is a song of gratitude that Jews sing each year at the Passover Seder when we retell the journey from slavery to freedom. And it recounts all the things that God has done. We say, if God had taken us out of Egypt but not given us the Torah, Dayenu, it would have been enough. And it goes on from there. And we named the organization I lead Dayenu because it also means we've had enough. We've had enough destruction, enough valuing of fossil fuel companies over human life, enough letting the impacts of climate destruction fall disproportionately on Black, Brown, Indigenous, poor, and marginalized communities. Enough! Dayenu, we say. But it's also a double entendre, because Dayenu also means we have enough. We have what we need to confront the climate crisis and move towards climate solutions. We have the resources and policy rubrics and technology. We have the people and power. We have what we need so everyone can have enough. Now is the time to join together in this urgent and sacred work. Nothing less than the future of humanity and our planet is at stake. It is time to act so that all people and their children and their children's children can live with enough for generations to come.
Thank you so much for that galvanizing message. And next up, we are so fortunate to now hear from a worldwide spiritual leader who has authored more than 75 books, including 22 New York Times bestsellers, and whose reach and insights have made a difference to millions across the world. Founder and chairman of the Chopra Foundation, here he is addressing the focus on female leadership, interviewed by actress and activist Gabriella Wright. Please welcome Deepak Chopra.
Thank you, Deepak, for bringing your voice to the female, the divine feminine leadership that we need to enhance today. It's an honor to have you for this event.
Here's the problem. We've been talking about climate change for decades now because people do not change behavior or policy based on science or facts. What people do is listen to facts but act on emotions. Mm-hmm. Now we have to look at the whole picture and we have to have an emotional and spiritual engagement in order to reverse climate change. That's where the feminine archetypal energies come in. Mm-hmm. If you think of the feminine archetypal energies as symbols or states of information and states of energy that can resurrect the soul of our collective humanity right now. And that requires the voice of the feminine. If we have a leadership that's based on these themes that I just mentioned and tells a new story, not about the environment and climate change only, but what it means for life on this planet. We are actually have become the predator. We are the cancer. Just look at a cancer cell. It gouges, it invades, it kills, it plunders. It is all about itself. That's what a cancer cell is. Which species is now the cancer of this planet? It's us. And it's a disturbed war, terrorism, eco-destruction, extinction of species, climate change, mechanized ways of killing each other from nuclear weapons to cyber warfare. This is a pathological male energy. We need to resurrect the divine feminine, but we also need to heal the male archetype, which can actually be very strong, but in a different way. Strength coming from love in action. Strength coming from compassion and empathy. Normally, when people think of love, they think, oh, you know, it's all sentimentality. It's not practical. And when they think of power, they think of this dominant power, ruthlessness. So the two don't go together. But actually, love and power together can resurrect humanity's soul and repair the biology of our ecosystem or our biosphere. We need the divine feminine now, urgently, as the nurturers and the caretakers of our planet, a power not based on violence, but on love. So count me in as an ambassador of the divine feminine for climate change.
Thank you so much, Deepak. Thank you.
Thank you, Deepak and Gabriella, for your insightful words. Our next speaker is a food justice activist, farmer, and founder of Rise and Root Farm. Her farm in Hudson Valley, New York, recently was impacted by the flooding caused by Hurricane Ida. I can't wait to hear what she has to share with us. Please welcome Karen Washington.
So good evening. My name is Karen Washington. I tell people I grow food, I feed people body and mind. I'm a farmer, y'all. However, growing up, I never thought that I was going to be a farmer because I was told as a black person, farming was equated to slavery. The fact that I never questioned the food system, never asked where the food came from, who grew it, were people and animals in the environment treated humanely? Granted, my mom was a good cook, 3 meals a day, but I never questioned the food system until I moved to the Bronx and had a backyard, and I decided to grow three things: eggplant, collard greens, and tomatoes. Eggplant because it's a little funky. Tomatoes because they came in a cellophane, three in a carton, and they were pale. And it wasn't until I grew my tomato plant, what? It grew on a vine? It was red, and I bit into it, and woo, I was hooked and wanted to grow everything. 3 years later, I happened to come upon an empty lot and turn that empty lot into a community garden. But while I was there, I started to see the social issues that were affecting my community: climate change, environmental injustice, health disparities, affordable housing, all these things that were making me question the food system. Question the food system, because I heard time and time again that the food system was broken and it needed to be fixed. And then I realized, no, the food system is doing exactly what it's supposed to be doing. It's a caste system based on the color of your skin, how much money you make, and where you live. And so now I go throughout the country to challenge the food system, and you need to challenge the food system, because it doesn't need to be fixed. It needs to change. And that change is the shifting of power back into the hands of communities and communities that look like me. Shifting power back into marginalized community. Because when we talk about food justice, we have to talk about the meaning of food justice, the transformation of the food system to eliminate the disparities that we often see. And that shifting, when we talk about transformation, is active. So if you're going to do food justice, you must be actively moving to dismantle the social injustice. Same with food sovereignty, being co-opted, because food sovereignty came from the global south of peasants trying to fight for self-governance, which is so, so important if we're going to change this food system. And one last thing I want to talk about is food deserts. Don't say that word, food desert, because it's the outsider term trying to denote exactly the fact that we don't have access to supermarkets or food. Yes, we do. We have the junk food, the fast food. So what I do is I use the term food apartheid. Food apartheid, because I want people to understand, if we are going to change this food system in such a way, we need to have those hard conversations about why, in the greatest country in the world, where we grow enough food and we waste enough food, that food is not getting down to the people that need it the most. So what I tell you to do, your homework assignment, is to be proactive and not reactive. When you see injustice, call it out. Don't be afraid of people who look different than you. Break bread and have a meal with someone who looks different. And at the end of the day, this is a country that should pride itself on diversity and inclusion. Because as a farmer, that's what I see along the plants and flowers that I grow. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Wasn't that so powerful and an important reminder? Wait, clap again, please. An important reminder that language matters. Food apartheid is what's going on in many communities, not just across the United States, but across the world. And people have the right to have access to healthy food for healthy societies, for healthy systems. Our next speaker, speaking of affecting millions of people and creating leaders in this movement, I was only 8 years old when I first watched An Inconvenient Truth. Our next speaker, Al Gore. And
and I remember being only 2 months into my internship for the honorable congressman and civil rights icon, Congressman John Lewis, when I traveled to Atlanta, Georgia, and was interviewed by Vice President Al Gore. And from then on, I continued climate striking.
In 2019, I went to a climate reality training, and not only did I learn more about this crisis, but I was able to meet so many other inspiring people, and for that, I really appreciated. Now, of course, he needs no introduction, but I will. He is the former Vice President of the U.S., recipient of the Nobel Peace Prize in 2007, jointly with the IPCC. and he is the founder of the Climate Reality Project. So please welcome Al Gore.
Hello, everyone. It's such a pleasure to be speaking to you tonight. In a time when some people are feeling climate despair, it's incredibly powerful to take part in an event like this that inspires so much hope, and the hope is legitimate, and we've never needed it more. We are at a pivotal moment in our fight against the climate crisis. From floods and rain bombs that seemingly come out of nowhere, to deep and punishing droughts that seemingly never end, the impacts of the climate crisis are growing in severity at a staggeringly rapid pace. We simply must take action quickly and boldly to forestall this looming catastrophe and begin solving the climate crisis. By focusing on the importance of community building, on empathy, and by fostering a collaborative approach to driving change, we can reimagine the systems that are focused on short-term benefit to the detriment of long-term progress. Indeed, it's only through the inclusion of a wide diversity of backgrounds, opinions, perspectives, and life experiences that our best solutions can arise. In order to solve the climate crisis, we're going to need diverse voices across every background and dimension, except one. We need to share the common value of collaboration, and we must share a commitment to being a positive force for change. And so I challenge all of you to think about how you can work within your communities, your own spheres of influence, to effect change. Use your voice. Use your vote. Use your choices as consumers and community members to become a true leader. There are already so many people, women and men alike, and especially the young people like our hosts, Alexandria, Xiye, and Jerome, who are already powerful change makers. I'm proud that over the past 15 years, our team at the Climate Reality Project has trained more than 36,000 leaders, more than half of whom are women, by the way, to build networks and communities to drive climate action from the ground up. And I'm especially proud to introduce one of those leaders. In fact, one of our very first climate reality leaders, Harriet Sugarman. As an author and activist and a mother, Harriet has worked tirelessly to communicate the urgency of the climate crisis and to educate others about the steps they can take to combat it. Her dedication to this issue stemmed from a desire to connect and influence her own community. Now a successful author, columnist, founder of Climate Reality Project's New York City chapter, and so much more, Harriet continues to inspire me with her steadfast commitment to this cause. She has inspired so many to become change makers on their own. I have no doubt she will provide some inspiration here tonight as well. So it is my pleasure and honor to introduce and to welcome the incomparable Harriet Sugarman.
Wow. Thank you so very much, Mr. Gore. We all know that you will and always will be a phenomenal and good ancestor. But what about the rest of us? Will we have been good ancestors? That's a weighty question, and one that without a time machine to see into the future, we can't accurately know for sure. But we can take some educated guesses, and broadly, given the clear and deafening warnings Mother Nature keeps sending us, we seem not to be on the good ancestor path. Or are we? So I want to turn things around tonight because I believe we are. Joanna Macy has aptly coined the phrase, the great turning, and I see a million mamas from all over the world joining in as part of this great transition. Mamas and papas who are meeting up on the path that intersects in a myriad of places and a myriad of ways. And together, we rise up. And our movement grows daily from a place of fierce love for our children. My part of the story begins 14 years ago, in 2007, when, as Mr. Gore shared, I completed one of the early and still nascent climate reality trainings. Then, like now, Mr. Gore personally trains people from all across our country and around the world to go back to their communities, to talk about the climate crisis, to share the realities we face, and to encourage and empower people to act on climate. A decade and a half later, as Mr. Gore shared, the trainings continue. That 2007 training forever changed the direction and the course of my life. It helped me to look deep within my heart and find my purpose and my path. Climate Mama was born 2 years later and became the first targeted parent-focused climate organization in the US, and I believed at that time the first in the world. Over the years, our community and the parent movement, climate movement here in the United States has grown online and off, together and separately. However, I know that too many climate mamas and papas want to join us, but they can't, as they struggle to keep their families together and safe. They're living on the front lines of fossil fuel extraction, in the shadow of power plants, and in the harsh path of climate impacts. And too often, they're reeling from environmental racism made worse by the global pandemic. Our Climate Mama motto, then and now, has been tell the truth, actions speak louder than words, and don't be afraid. Easier said than done. But we must do so with our eyes wide open, and we stand beside, in front, and behind wherever needed for our children and for all climate mamas and papas. The Fridays for Future youth movement and climate strikes help jumpstart the global climate movement. The great transition and the creation of good ancestors is underway. And like many movements, it's been built on a strong foundation forged over decades and centuries. Parents are rising up, supporting one another, hearing and answering the call and the cries of our children. This summer, Our Kids Climate and Parents for Future Global jointly launched a parent fellowship, supporting 12 amazing mamas in 11 countries as a coordinated approach to grow and connect the parent organizing around the globe. I believe deeply and strongly that the great transition has begun, and we, as intergenerational colleagues, friends, and family, will see it through. We will be called good ancestors by our great-great-grandchildren. But we have no time to waste, as these pictures of my children show us. Life marches on, and time really does fly by. So today, on this full moon evening, Mother Nature is lighting our way. So join us as we rise up together. Thank you.
Thank you, Harriet. And we have heard from so many speakers tonight, but I have a couple more surprises. One surprise in particular is that later on tonight, the former president of Ireland, Mary Robinson, we'll close our event tonight with a conversation with my co-host, Xiye Bastida. But first, let's introduce another speaker. And that is Deanna Cohen, an artist, a surfer, a person who grew up in nature, a person that lived alongside nature as a young person, who then worked with plastic and understood that they decompose in nature and that they continue to pervade all across our environments. So she was inspired by the idea to create change and the idea to clean up by co-founding the Plastic Pollution Coalition, which is a mission of working towards a world free of plastic pollution. And she, over the years, has built a coalition of over 750 organizations, businesses, and notable ambassadors. And she specifically said that she loves to mentor young people. So it's great to be here. And please welcome the co-founder of Plastic Pollution Coalition, Deanna Cohen.
I can move over there? Okay, great. Good evening, you guys. I just have to start out by saying I'm so deeply moved by the different presentations that have come before me that I'm actually concerned that I'm gonna be really emotional, but I'll do my best to not be. I grew up in Southern California, and
with a deep love of the ocean. Just remembered I have a clicker. This is an image from Bahia, Brazil, that was sent to me by coalition members who we work with. I like to ask people to take your hand for a second and put it up and just look at the very top of the image, the trees and the far distance and the ocean, and think to yourself, this is a beautiful place where I'd like to go, I'd like to swim, and then take your hand away and realize that this could be any beach anywhere in the world. This could be the beaches in Santa Monica in Southern California where I grew up. This could be beaches in Hawaii or beaches in the Caribbean or coastal communities anywhere from Africa to India to Indonesia. Plastic pollution is a global crisis, and plastic is the petrochemical industry and oil and fossil fuels made tangible. So it is in front of us, it's in our hands, we utilize it every day, and it's poisoning us. I say all of that to you, and I still wake up every morning and I feel incredibly hopeful. Our coalition, Plastic Pollution Coalition, has grown since 2009 to over 1,200 organizations, and in the last 3 years, also businesses, almost 50% businesses and organizations from 75 different countries, all working together to stop plastic pollution and to raise awareness about the toxic impact of plastic and the chemicals in plastic on human health, animal health, the ocean, waterways, and the environment. I want to do a shout out for a moment to Dr. Sylvia Earle, who's one of my mentors. When she won the Ted Wish Prize back in, I think it was also in 2009, she said that she wanted to protect the ocean, the blue heart of the planet. And as we started at the beginning of this evening with Amanda Gorman talking about that moonshot, that view from space, from the Apollo and from the moon of Earth, and how Earth looks like a tiny little blue marble. We live on an ocean planet. The ocean and water are the reason that there is human life on Earth. And it is unbelievable to me that we somehow have done so much damage in such a short amount of time, and that we've treated our ocean, which we've barely explored. I was just reading that we know more about the surface of Mars right now than we have explored our oceans. That this is, the ocean is providing every second breath that we breathe. And this is so important to me, particularly when I see the devastating impact of fossil fuels and plastic on our ocean, on the wildlife and sea life that live in the ocean, on us and how it comes back to us, and the way that we package our food and beverages, our beauty products, our household cleaning products, our health products in this material. And the production of it is just ramping up. So all of that to say, what can we do about it? And what do we wake up every day and think about in terms of solutions? Plastic in the ocean. When I first realized that plastic was in the ocean, I began to follow that chain upstream. And I followed it to the market, the supermarket, the health food market. I followed it into the refrigerator in my own home and what I was providing for my family. And what it brought me around to as a visual artist and a person who was interested in science and in truth is how do we function? How do we take this kind of nexus of science and art and communication and communicate to other people, empower them, educate them so that they can be part of the change and part of the system shift that we need to make happen and the cultural shift that we need to make happen to divest from fossil fuels, but also to divest from plastic, to break free from plastic, and to break free from plastic pollution. So that said, I want to honor some of my colleagues who work on this every day, including Yvette Arellano, who's based in Houston, Texas, and founded Fenceline Watch. She's living in a community that is directly impacted by the fossil fuel industry and the production of plastic. And what we're seeing is that plastic and our use of plastic disproportionately impacts BIPOC communities and fence line communities across the United States and also around the world, and in ways that perhaps people are not thinking of yet. I've found that when I meet people, often they are not aware that plastic is made from petroleum and from fossil fuels. So Yvette is there working on the front line, and she has to come in contact with the health issues that are associated with plastics, including the impact to human health, with reproductive health, sterility, infertility, the connections between the materials used to make plastics and the plasticizing chemicals, which are endocrine disruptors, and breast cancer, brain cancer, prostate cancer, as well as contributing to diabetes and obesity. I also want to honor Jackie Nunez. She's the founder of The Last Plastic Straw. She's like a one-woman show who got on her bike and started talking to people about looking at plastic straws as a key to a door that would help you see all of the single-use plastics, maybe unnecessary single-use plastics that we're surrounded by and that have become normalized, or that we feel make our life more convenient. But the truth is that they are not convenient. They're not convenient for our health, and they're not convenient for the planet, our environment, the ocean, the air we breathe, et cetera. So Jackie does this work, and she really supports cool ideas, ideas of refill, reuse, ideas of using reusable materials. She coined a phrase of she always carries like an urban packer kit with her, which is, when I've been with her, she always has reusable little camping plates. She was a river guide, so she brings that river guide ethos to her daily life and everything that she does. And I feel like I've really learned a lot from her, and that she is doing great work with this, and also as a policy director for Plastic Pollution Coalition. And then I also really want to highlight our youth ambassadors and the young people who are working on this, including Xiye Bastida, who's here and one of our hosts. This is Hannah Testa. Hannah was able to go to Washington, D.C., to the Capitol, to help introduce a piece of federal legislation called the Break Free from Plastic Pollution Act. This is federal legislation. I think this is something that we can all get behind and we can all support. And it will do everything. It's very comprehensive, and it will do everything from requiring that we stop building new facilities to frack, crack, you know, drill for plastics and different chemicals that are used to make plastics. You know, you have to realize that plastic is the fossil fuel industry's plan B. So as we see this large move, this big shift away, and this divestment, what ends up happening is there's a shift going on where they shift to making single-use plastic and single-use plastic water bottles, as if that's necessary. So I see a deep power, a great power in the work of our youth ambassadors and young people all around the world. And I feel that they are my mentors in the way that they approach this subject. They look at it collaboratively, intergenerationally. They look at it as in a very solution-oriented way. And they give me great hope. I was thinking about what Amanda Gorman said right at the beginning of this evening. And she said that the time to act is now. Now, now. And I encourage us all to take what others have said this evening and really take it to heart, digest it, and tomorrow turn around and support federal legislation, the International Plastic Treaty that people are talking about at UN and UNEA, to get involved in any way that you can that moves us towards the system shift we need to implement a reusable, refillable, restorative, regenerative world, planet, life for us now, for the generations to come. I implore you, please, we're happy to help, we're happy to collaborate.
reach out to us if we can be of help. And I think that we're much more powerful together. And together, we're rising. Let's do it. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Deanna, for sharing your inspiring work. Next, we have a special performance from the youngest ever runner-up at America's Got Talent at 9 years old. And she received 2 golden buzzers, which makes her the youngest to ever receive them. At the United Nations, on occasion of International Women's Day this year, she debuted the song You Are About to Hear. We are so grateful to her and her team's generosity in sharing this performance with us, and we honor just some of the women in climate icons upon whose shoulders we stand. Let's hear the message of Looking Up from Angelica Hale.
I'm just a girl, you may think I'm at a disadvantage. Going out into the world, but I think I'm gonna take my chances. Cause no one ever changed a thing by being too afraid of a dream. So if I'm ever feeling down, I know that it's part of the journey. I look up to the stars in the sky. I look up and I feel so inspired to push every limit, like all of the women before me. I look up in the face of my fear, won't give up till they know I was here. Won't stand in the shadows, cause she fought the battles before me. She's looking up to you, and she's looking up to you. Use the magic of your voice and tell them what you stand for. Cause we don't change the world when we whisper, we change it when we roar. If you take the time to see, then all you gotta do is believe. There are highs and there are lows, but the power's in finding the beauty. Oh yeah, I look up to the stars in the sky. I look up and I feel so inspired to push every limit, like all of the women. Oh, I look up in the face of my fears, won't give up till they know I was here. Won't stand in the shadows, cause she fought the battles before me. And she's looking up, I am her and she is me. The ladder keeps on growing. Oh, and one day you become the hero that keeps it going. I look up to the stars in the sky. I look up and I feel so inspired to push every limit, like all of the women made for me. Oh, I look up in the face of my fears, won't give up till they know I was here. Once down in the shadows, cause she fought the battles before me. And she's looking up to.
That was so amazing. Thank you so much, Angelica, for your presence. And before we continue, I just want to invite everyone to take a deep breath because it's been a very long night. And we only have 2 more speakers to go, and then we get to talk to each other and have a great start to Climate Week. So everyone, take a deep breath with me. Awesome. Thank you. Our next speaker is Sally Rani, who is the co-founder of Global Choices and its international and intergenerational network of Arctic Angels that I am proud to be a part of. As a child, she loved being in nature, and as a young married woman, she took on the forces that wanted to clear-cut a forest. Sally protested and actually won the case. That experience launched her storied and decades-long career as a female leader in climate justice. Please welcome Sally Rani.
Well, I am really delighted to be here. I'm honored to be here, to be asked to speak with such an amazing array of women and men who have dedicated themselves, and young people who are coming up the ranks and dedicating themselves so young to climate change and climate justice. I'm going to take a little different tact here today. We are all born of the same elements. The sand, the soil, the air, the water, the fishes, the birds. We're not separate from anything, including men. We're all connected, and we're all of everything. At this point in time, what is so exciting is that we are nature remembering itself. And this is where some of this uprising is coming from. It's tender, it's new, but it's happening. Women look at life differently than men, because we are the life givers. We are central now to a great transformation, to a passage that is coming. We're naturally nurturing, we're compassionate, our basic impulse is collaborative, and even though our society has been teaching us forever competition, relentless competition, our basic instinct is to value the whole. Women have deeply embedded shared values. We prioritize life because we are the life givers, and we're the primary caretakers of our own children and the unborn children of the next generation. We know that whatever diminishes the creation diminishes all of us, and disproportionately. It's very important in this movement to take back the narrative. In fact, it's absolutely necessary for the shift in systems and in expanded consciousness awareness of where we are in history, because it's often, when you're in the middle of the history, it's hard to know exactly what your position is. How could we let pro-life be stolen from us? I am pro-life for life on this planet. We have to take that back. I'm pro-life for all species, not just humans, all species. We are all connected. So the old paradigm was manifested on the concepts of using, depleting, degrading, hoarding, short-term profits to make the old paradigm obsolete. And from the inside out, we have to take on a new narrative, and we have. And it is a narrative of life. Restore, reclaim, reuse, replenish, relax, and remember our relations. Speak it, live it, vote it. remind our leaders that foreign policy is by necessity now climate policy and climate justice policy. It is not separate. And it's essential for the whole systems understanding, because everything is connected to everything else. All the Earth systems are dependent and interdependent on one another. It's imperative that whole systems understanding and thinking now be incorporated into decision making. So we are leading a grand transformation. And what's interesting in this transformation is we're all born with an original knowledge, an innate knowing of how to rightfully live with and on this planet with all the other species. But it has been, this original knowledge has been buried alive with educational systems, technology, hyper-communication, hyper-mobility, hyper-virtuality. Indigenous women and youth are leading, and women are leading a great transformation of heart intelligence, to listen to that, and compassionate minds. And this is why the change, because we can no longer live as dangerously out of balance that we are now. And we're doing so more every single day. So a monumental correction was needed, and it has arisen. And it is the divine feminine, and other people have spoken about this today. But it actually, there was no other choice, because this is the genius of nature. This is a divine choreography. Mother Nature knows when things are out of balance, and there will be a correction. She will right what is wrong, and she will make sure that we swing back into balance. And so it was inevitable that the divine feminine would rise. And just in time, I have to say, and I'm going to get very specific here, is that we, the collective, are facing the greatest global SOS of our time. Polar ice is going extinct, in particular, the Arctic sea ice, which is the centerpiece of an indispensable planetary cooling system. This is happening right under our noses, on our watch. And this is not just about polar bears, because it turns out, the truth is, we are all ice-dependent species. What happens in the Arctic doesn't stay in the Arctic. It's now everybody's business. And I can't go through all the science, there isn't time, but the main piece of this is that the sea ice reflects the sun, the sun's heat and radiation. And it's now compromised, depending on which scientist you talk to 50 to 54%. So the jet stream, it was smooth around the northern realms, is now like this. The Gulf Stream and the AMOC have slowed down. They're out of whack. Northern Africa, in fact, half of Africa, has more droughts and more floods that are now linked to the loss of Arctic sea ice. The heat dome in the Pacific South, the Pacific Northwest, just recently linked to the loss of sea ice. Less precipitation in the Amazon linked to loss of sea ice, and fires in California. So this is everybody's business. But interestingly enough, you know, it has been mostly unattended until now. And so my organization has taken this on, and we're a David and a Goliath situation. and we need everyone's help and support. We are proposing that the Central Arctic Ocean ice shield, our cooling system, be protected for 10 years under a moratorium that would prohibit deep seabed mining, oil and gas exploration, seismic testing, nuclear weapon testing, radioactive waste dumping, and new shipping lanes across the North Pole. And the hope is, there is hope, and the hope is all the young people that are here tonight and that are watching, and all of those who are supporting them in their quest for, and their mission for a livable world. We have formed an international group that's intergenerational, called the Arctic Angels. They're in 25 countries and growing very quickly. And these women, they're Xiye, these women are absolutely incredible. They do their own work and they recognize the global impacts of the Arctic situation. And so they've come and stood up, are standing up for that as well. We mentor them, we foster leadership, we create bridges to policymakers, experts, we provide speaking and press opportunities to raise awareness, but it doesn't make any sense at all to raise awareness that doesn't translate into very effective, meaningful action. So we are creating a wall of women that is porous, but also is so strong. And if we all walk forward together, we can make the changes, we can make the shifts that have to happen so we have a livable world for our future. And what we do and what I do is I work for the next generations of all species, because without them, we will be in such poverty, spiritual and soul poverty. So I hope that you will join us. And now is our time. And you know, the only way you can predict the future is to design it. And our future is indivisible. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Sally, for those, you know, everything, for the work that you do, for the organizations that you've started, and for inspiring the next generation of leaders. Next up is Mary Robinson, who served as the 7th President of Ireland, as well as the United Nations High Commissioner for Human Rights, and currently sits as Chair of the Elders. When Ban Ki-moon, former Secretary General, was launching his effort on climate change, he knew he needed a woman, and he knew that that woman was Mary Robinson. In many ways, Mary was the face of the climate movement early on in the global community. And when Nelson Mandela created the Elders, for world leaders to continue to serve and inspire, the first person he invited on board was Mary Robinson. So without further ado, please welcome a champion, leader, and inspiration, Mary Robinson. Here we are. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. A very far away trip from Ireland.
Yes.
We are so happy to for you to join us as our closing remarks and, you know, event up for the night. So I have a few questions for you tonight. And the first one...
Before that, can I just say...
Go ahead.
You know, this is the first time I've been at a meeting in person like this on climate for ages. I was so sick of Zoom. And you know, we all need this. We all need evenings like this. You know, I really thank you, Xiye, Jerome, and Alexandra for co-hosting and for giving us the whole idea of how we can collaborate. I mean, yes, I'll answer your questions now, but I feel very excited, very energized, very fired up. Yeah.
Amazing. Yeah, the last time Mary and I saw each other was actually at COP25, almost more than two years ago. So yeah. This is a very exciting moment that we're able to kind of be back together in person, and hopefully you'll continue that way. So my first question, as a former leader in many different sectors, is how to be a good leader? What is the responsibility of a leader? And how can we as youth make demands from people who are in positions of leadership?
To me, the idea of leadership is to serve. It's to serve the people who place their trust in you by electing you. I remember being extraordinarily moved and affected when the people of Ireland elected me as the first woman president. It was just an incredible honor to serve. And that's really what leadership has to be about, you know.
Yeah, that goes back to, you know, our panelists who have mentioned, we actually need to invoke leadership as what it is. It's our channel for action and for results.
Yeah, but leadership can happen at all levels. You're a young climate leader. You're already, you know, phenomenal, like your two fellow hosts. We need youth to take on that leadership. Leadership at community level, leadership in the front lines, the brave frontline human rights defenders and community defenders. This year has been the worst year for frontline defenders to be killed, defending their water rights, their land rights, their communities. And we have to remember that.
Yeah, and moving deeper into that point, what do you think, because you have been a champion on highlighting frontline communities in the climate movement, why do you see as some of our biggest issues in the climate movement, but also ways to overcome it through diversity?
I think, personally, we just need to understand the layers of injustice that require a climate justice approach. And, you know, I'll give you very quickly at least five layers that affect me personally. You know, it's what drives me in the work that I'm doing. And the first is the very obvious one, that climate change affects disproportionately and much earlier the poorest countries, the poorest communities, small island states, and indigenous peoples. And they're the least responsible. They also happen to be the black and brown and indigenous peoples of our world. So there's a racial injustice. So we link. I'm really glad that there is such a sense now among young people in particular of that intersectionality of these movements. Secondly, the gender dimension within that. Women have different social roles, different power, different access to credit, and yet they have to still go further for water in drought. They have to put food on the table, make their communities resilient, and so many of them with such courage do that. Thirdly, the intergenerational injustice. I don't have to tell you about that because you tell me. And fourthly, and it's important, the injustice of the different pathways to development. You know, the industrialized countries, we built our economies on fossil fuel. Now our responsibility is to wean ourselves off much more quickly than we're doing, and to do it with just transition, to honor the workers in coal and oil and gas who helped to build our economies, with pensioning off if they've done it for most of their lives, or providing new jobs, new training for those workers. So just transition is an extraordinarily important part of moving forward. But for developing countries, they have to develop, and we haven't provided enough of the investment in the clean energy, the skills, the training, the transfer of technology. And, you know, there's a big issue there of taking your people out of poverty. And, of course, it's worsened by COVID, as we know. And then the fifth injustice is the injustice to nature, which has come out very much this evening, the loss of biodiversity, the extinction of species. But, you know, behind all that is what I see, and I see it emerging in front of my eyes this evening in so many different ways, a kind of climate justice broad movement that embraces all the things we've heard this evening. And it's that movement that has to stand up. And it's a very feminist movement, as we've heard this evening, a feminist movement with very supportive men who themselves understand the feminist values. And that's what's important.
My last question is, you know, I've been through the work that I've done and many young people, the work that we've done, we do it sometimes to get into positions where we can be part of the conversation. And I've had the opportunity to be in conversation with many leaders, including 40 heads of state at the Biden summit. And most of those times, leaders tell me, and older generations tell me, thank you for your activism, and they don't tell me what they're going to do about the crisis. Mm. So my question is, what is your message to your generation about their responsibility for being good ancestors, like our theme is today?
I can't defend my generation because we have not been good stewards. We have not done enough at all. Some of us have tried within that, but overall, and especially among leaders, even now, 2 days ago, the UN reported that instead of reducing fossil fuel by 45% by 2030 to get on track for a 1.5-degree world, under current actions and what is committed so far, we would increase by 16%. This is not acceptable. And, you know, I see the sort of anger in young people and the frustration when you're praised for your climate activism and you're told you're great and you're very articulate and all that. But it's not enough. We actually need at this COP to see the climate action. And that's why this movement has to very seriously pin down those who are the real perpetrators. You know, the 100 companies that are mainly responsible, the banks that are responsible, the countries that haven't made commitments. And those countries are, some of them are very big emitters now. They're emerging countries that are big emitters, or countries like Australia, which as a developed country, shockingly, still has not made a proper commitment. The United States needs to commit much more climate finance. It is much under the level of climate finance. But China, India, Saudi Arabia, Turkey, Brazil, all of these countries need to make serious commitments, and we need to encourage them. And we just need to realize that we can track more clearly. Everything's becoming more evident. Court cases are succeeding now against Shell, against other companies. And we're going to see more litigation and more work of Carbon Tracker and all these that are pinpointing where the gaps are. And we mustn't leave the COP in Glasgow without closing those gaps. We must get on course. And we have to actually have faith this COP will deliver. Because if we go in saying, I don't know if it's going to do as much as we... Then, we must... As we did in Paris, we had the pressure of the civil society, the indigenous peoples, the small island states, the Climate Funders Forum. I remember because I was the UN... envoy of the Secretary General. It was those with the urgency in their voice, they made the difference, and we've got to continue to do that. We are the ones who are urgent together, and we collaborate together, we work together, we care so much about our world and its future, especially for future generations. And so we have to have our voice very strongly at COP26, and actually very strongly over the next few days at UNGA, that's blocking all the traffic.
Thank you so much, Mary. And I love that you called out all the countries, the companies, the politicians, because that's what we need. We need truth,
yes,
courage, and solutions.
Yeah, absolutely. Truth to power. And that's why, you know, young people keep doing it, but, the most important thing is the collaboration that we've heard about this evening, the rising, the feminist values that we've heard about so clearly. And as I said, I'm lifted and heartened myself. And we all need that. We need hope. And we need Archbishop Tutu calls it being a prisoner of hope, and I like that expression because it means then you have the energy to fight, you have the energy to make a difference, you've got energy to, you know, make it personal in your life, get angry with those who don't take responsibility. And the third thing, and I really want, Xiye, I want you and Jerome and Alexandra and all you young climate activists to talk more about this world we need to be arriving at in 9 years' time. In 2030. What is this world? It's going to be so much healthier. It's going to be a world where we won't have the pollution of fossil fuel, the deaths that it causes, but indoor and outdoor pollution. You know, more than 5 million deaths a year. And the it will be a world of the greening of cities, the regeneration. Speak more about that.
We need to imagine the future and create the future that
absolutely.
We want to see.
And create it in a very positive sense of that's why we want to get there. If we don't imagine it and talk about it enough, and we won't create that emotional energy to get there. And I do agree, people are not influenced by facts, they're influenced by emotions. If we can have the emotion driving us that we really want this world, because it's going to be a clean, regenerated nature, in harmony with nature, beautiful world. And, it's going to be a much more equal world because there's going to be clean energy to developing countries to help bring people out of poverty much more rapidly and so on. And the Sustainable Development Goals will be at the heart of it. So, it's been a great evening. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Hey, thank you.
Wow, thank you all so much for joining us. This has been an incredible evening. I hope that you've all been taking notes and know what type of actions you want to take next after seeing all these inspiring speakers. And I actually have one action I want to recommend you all do. This Friday is going to be the next global climate strike. And here in New York City, there will be a march starting at City Hall. So I hope to see you all there.
Yeah.
And also, we want to give a thank you to the organizations that sponsored this event. Oftentimes, you have to think about the intersectionality between movement pressure and grassroots organizations, and the duty and responsibility of organizations to make meaningful internal changes while also having systemic external reconciliation with communities. And today, we're seeing the first steps of that by having Accenture and Salesforce here to support this event.
As a wrap-up, thank you all so much for spending your evening with us. We are so grateful, and we hope you learned something new today, that you have a new passion, newfound passion, to build this movement together with us. So thank you again so much. Have a wonderful night, everyone.
Yeah.
I was dreaming in my dreaming of an aspect bright and fair. But in my sleeping, it was broken. But my dream, it lingered near in the farmer. Shining valleys where the pure air recognized all in my senses newly opened, all our waking on into the cry that the people have the power to redeem the work of fools from the meek, the grace to shower. Low, pleasant to hear.
the armies ceased advancing because the people had their ear. And then the shepherds and the soldiers, and they laid among the stars, strange visions, laying arms to waste in the dust, in the form of shining valleys where the pure air recognized. And my senses newly opened, and my light awakened to the cry. I saw fountains like cream, the waters rise, and we strolled there together, when no laugh or precise, when the leopard and the lamb and me together, truly bound, but I was hoping, in my hoping, to recall what I found, when I was dreaming. I lay down into my sleeping, like a mat, my dream with you.
People love the power.